One very important thing is this higher study is a start. If you go there and get some knowledge after your graduation in Bangladesh, that will help you to work anywhere in the world. And for that thing, actually, you may choose, first of all, USA. If you have US degree, you can work anywhere in the world. It is accepted anywhere in the world. And then also someone from Europe, that will cover, well, at least in Asian countries and Europe and part of Africa. So with these things, you will have some exposure to the world, and maybe you are already familiar with some of those things from internet, but here it will provide you a complete view and a guideline for you how to go and which way and where, what should be the procedure. There might maybe some third-year students, I don't know exactly, maybe some second-year students, or maybe some graduates who already graduated. So there should be some clear path for everyone. Whatever your current position is, you follow this track and you will be successful at it. For these things, we actually pick two of our faculty members, Mr. Nahid-Ur-Rahman and Mehedi Hasan. Our selection of speaker is very special kind of stuff. For example, Mehdi Hasan, who is working as a lecturer in the civil engineering department at AUST, he got some scholarship from University of Central Florida, Orlando, Florida, and he got visa and everything. So for him, all set, all these things he did in last 1 year or 2 years, something like that. So, like, from him, you will come to know the current procedure right now, because it's the latest one. I think he's flying on 28th of December. He's flying on 28th of December, so that's the best one in one sense. So you can ask him some questions like, how should we prepare ourselves, what should we do, how to apply about some financial relationship, education, everything, and also maybe about the visa stuff. So I'm sure that he can provide you some concrete picture how to get admission and this visa stuff and the financial stuff to give us. And secondly, we choose Mr. Nahid-Ur-Rahman. For him, he just came back. Okay, so he went. Maybe, so all his process was several years back. And after doing all those things, Germany. So he went to Germany and all those things were done. And now he is back. So Germany is, you know, an engineering especially, they are among the world leaders, not now, all along. So always there is a world leading stuff. So he might have some clear view about the standard and scope in Germany, and well, now you have the European Union, so for Germany and stuff, it will be the same thing more or less in the other world. So he can provide you the other version. Other version means once you complete your degree over there, what will you do? Okay, so for the first one, he will provide you how to go, and the second person. Of course, both of them will cover the entire stuff, but for the second one, as he already spent some time over there in Germany, so he can provide you the extra stuff. Now, I believe this seminar is going to be a very fruitful one for you people, and try to get the most out of it. So whatever question you have in your mind, please ask them and just get the entire benefit. That's all you want, we want. And I don't know if I'll get another chance, so at this moment I have to thank my colleagues from IEEE student branch for arranging such kind of seminar, and I believe it will be very nice. Thank you very much.
Our first respected speaker is Nahid-Ur-Rahman Chowdhury sir, who is currently working as an assistant professor in Hasnat University of Science and Technology in the Department of IEEE. Sir completed his BSc from Hasnat University of Science and Technology and pursued MSc abroad in AIT Germany and IST Portugal. I'd like to invite Sir to share his experience and guide us with his knowledge for the participants of this seminar. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Before I start, I would like to ask you how many of you are from EEE department? Oh, almost all of you. And some from any other departments? Which department?
Civil
engineering. Okay. Then it will be easier for me to elaborate things. Okay.
You will control?
Okay, next. So I will basically focus on higher studies aspects in Europe, and I would like to share with you the most challenges that you will face during your application processes and what are the opportunities that you can avail throughout your study in Europe. And next one. And before I go further, first I will introduce myself. I graduated from AUST. I was in EEE 19th batch, and then I was looking for higher studies in Europe and USA. But there was a good chance that I got from KIT, Karlsruhe Institute for Technology. This is one of the best engineering university in Germany. And if you know that this university is ranked among 100 most ranked universities in the whole world. And as most of the European universities require you to be an exchange student at least for one semester to another European country and another university. So I have to choose another university, and I chose IST. It is in Lisbon, Portugal. And this is also ranked around 300 in the whole world. And the funding that I got for my master's studies, it was provided by Peak Energy. This is a sub-part of European Union. The most famous scholarship that people got is Erasmus Mundus Scholarship. And this one is another new scholarship program which was introduced in the year 2010. And we were the second batch to avail this scholarship. And after completing my master's from these two universities, I worked for 1 year at IFA. It is a research institute based on, do you know the name EDF, Electricity de France? This is like DESCO of Bangladesh. Okay, so EDF is doing what DESCO is doing in Bangladesh. And EDF, in collaboration with KIT, they organized an institute or set up an institute at KIT. To make their research and development work more easier. And in this institute, there were students from all over Europe. So I luckily got chance here to work as a research assistant for 1 year. And after completing all this, I came back to Bangladesh in 2015, November. So before I start my presentation, I would like to say you one thing. Now you are going to start something new that you have never done before. So, to avail this, you have to do something which is also you never done before. So, just make a mindset that in the next slides, what you are going to see or what you will do after seeing these slides are totally new for you. Okay? So, let's start officially. When I say why you should study in Europe, there are several reasons, but for me, the most important reasons are these. First of all, you will get a world-class education, which will give you to reach your full potential. Whatever you want to study, whatever university you want to study, if you want, let's say you want to study nanotechnology, maybe right now in this country, this is not possible for you. Maybe in near future, it will be possible. But whatever subject comes to your mind that I want to study in this subject in Europe, it's possible. I think it's possible. The next thing is research. European research is state-of-the-art research. The university where I studied, KIT, they got 700 million euro per year only from German government for research purposes. So this is one of the best thing. The next thing is careers. After graduation, the most important thing in your life is what you should do. Do you want to go for a PhD? You want to stay in the academia? Or you want to go for a corporate job or engineering job? So when you have a BSc from Bangladesh, you have some exposure. But when you have a master's degree from a renowned European university, your exposure is more big. More people are now interested in you. Okay. So to shape your future career, it will be highly beneficial for you. And next is scholarships and costs. Most of the European universities, when they give admission to students from non-EU countries, non-EU means outside of Europe countries, mostly they give or they provide some kind of scholarship. It may be of many types. Let's say the tuition fee is waived. You don't have to pay any tuition fees. So what remains? Only your living expense. Or they will provide you some monthly allowance to support your living there. So there is enormous opportunities for scholarships. So you have to search the best one for you or what is available in your field of interest. And if you are paying for your studies, let's say you want to do a degree from Germany on your self-funding, that means you are providing your living and everything, then also you will get value for money. What you are expending in there for your 2 years master's degree, I think mostly you will get back this money within 2, 3 or 4 years if you get a job in Germany. Okay. So this is like, if you don't have a scholarship, don't get disheartened. There are some other ways to minimize the funding offer. And some less important things, but these are also very interesting, like diversity. Study the way you want. Let's say in my case, my program was diverse, means I have to choose at least one university anywhere from Europe to go for my exchange student, as an exchange student. So this was a good opportunity for me to explore same degree with one another university. So it was very much diverse, and the support and friendship that I made from these two universities, the support from university or friendship from people all around the world. Now I have friends in around 30 countries. But before going there, I only had friends from, let's say, 2 or 3 countries. So this is a great opportunity for you to make a network with people from the university, with people from your program, and also from others. And the cultural experience. Europe is very diverse. You know, they have a very limited area, but there are 30 countries. So the cultural experience will be also diverse for you. And you know that when you have a student visa or Schengen visa, you have entry to 27 countries. Only 3 countries are exempted from this. One is UK, one is Scotland, one is Ireland. Other than these 3 countries, you can travel anywhere you want. There is no requirement for visa. And then language. You can always study in English. Every country in Europe, they have English-based master's program. But also, if you wish, in fact, some people from Bangladesh, they study in German language for their master's degree. So there is two opportunities for you. If you want to study in English, it's also possible, no problem. But if you want to study in their local language, this is also a good chance. And this will help you when you are graduate. When you are a graduate, when you are looking for a job, not PhD, when you are looking for a job, the language that you have learned throughout this process is very, very advantageous for you. Next, I will elaborate this. So among the European countries, you see, which countries? Next, just click. So there are 30 countries, and the first thing comes to your mind, then where should I go for my higher studies? Not every country is rich. Not every country has that much research potential that you want, because you are moving from Bangladesh to Europe in pursuit of some good things that you can't get here, like, right? So when you choose your university, you should be very, very careful, because you are going to spend 2 or 3 more valuable years of your life, which will shape your future. So there is no chance of regretting after you choose your program, you go there, and there is no chance of coming back or just change the university. It will just waste your time. So from my experience, when I was applying in Europe, I chose firstly Germany and then the Central European countries. European countries are subdivided in very parts. Like Eastern European countries are the poorest countries in Europe. One example is, let's say, Poland or Romania. These are the poorest countries. So you can't go there, or you should not go there. You should never go to Greece. You should know about the economic conditions of these countries before you apply to that country. So I will elaborate this also later, but for now, keep these countries in your mind to apply when you are applying in Europe. Belgium, Denmark, Finland, France, Germany. Here you can apply to Italy, maybe Netherlands, Norway. Then you should apply to Sweden and here UK. Okay, so these countries can offer you the best research potential that you want. Next. So first of all, the challenges that you will face. Number one challenge is how to find the best fit program for yourself. Because when you just completed your BSc, your mind is set up something like this: okay, I just completed my master thesis in power, I will go for power. But things are not like this. After 6 months, maybe you changed your mind and now you want to study communication or you want to study electronics. So before choosing the program, ask yourself what I should do, okay? And if this program is the best fit program for myself, because if your interest and what you are studying is not matched, then it will be a devastating factor for your life. So if you just keep calm and ask Google, then there will be thousands of universities, thousands of websites and many things, and after 7 days you just close everything. Okay, I will not go for higher studies. So you should follow certain websites or certain scholarship programs where you will apply. Not you will apply randomly or haphazardly. Okay, I will apply this. Not like this. You should follow some criteria. So before considering a master's degree, one by one. First of all, you will ask yourself what kind of career you want to pursue after the course. This is the first important question. Do you want to be a faculty member in a university, or you want to do a job in a multinational company, or you want to do a pure engineering job? So focusing on your interest, then you will choose your degree. Next. Then you will ask yourself, what are my strengths? What are my strengths and weaknesses? Because in Bangladesh, we evaluate a student after just completing his BSc with his CGPA. But I personally believe CGPA does not reflect a person's potential. Means not 100% potential, because maybe in one semester you were sick and in that semester you had a poor CGPA, and for that your overall CGPA gets lower. But that doesn't mean that you have weaknesses or something like this. So you should know after graduating your BSc, you should know that I am more familiar, or I am more interested in power subjects, or I am more interested in nanotechnology or in telecommunication. So when you define your strengths and weaknesses very well, then it will be helpful for you to choose the right program for you. And then you know the answer for these two questions. Then the next question is, what are the most available master degree options for you? So that, what I say, when you are just searching randomly, then there will be so many programs and you will be confused which one I should choose. So just you have to, let's say, make a list of things that you will consider before choosing this university and this program particularly. And then let's say from Bangladesh you are seeing a very organized, wonderful website. And maybe you will be surprised that, okay, this university website is so nice. That means it will be a very high quality university. But there is also, not only in Europe, it is actually true for all over the world, that not website means everything. So when you choose a university, you go to their website, but maybe in some cases that will not reflect their actual potential. Because when we are marketing ourselves, we always make the best things to see for the people. So when you have chosen your university, first thing, if possible, try to make a contact with someone from that university. If he is from your university, this is the best. If he is from Bangladesh, you can also search. I have got many emails from Indian, Pakistanis, in fact Iranian people who are asking me, I want to study this program in KIT. Can you tell me about this question? Or can you just explain these things to me? So don't hesitate to contact anyone with this university. One way to search who is actually studying in this program is LinkedIn. How many of you have LinkedIn profiles? Okay, so just in the search box, write the university name, write the program. There will be at least 2, 3, 4, 5 persons who are studying this program. So just knock them. Maybe none will reply your question, but maybe one will reply, and that reply can change your life. You can change your mindset, or you can change the university. And the most important thing before you waste your money to apply, do you meet all the entry requirements? European universities are very much choosy when they offer a scholarship to a person. They will see your CGPA, they will see your letter of motivation, they will see the recommendation letters provided by the professors. And if somewhere something is missing, your application, what you made for 7 or 10 days is just waste of time. So if you do not meet all the entry requirements could be, let's say, KIT, when we apply, gave a base mark of CGPA 3.5 for students coming from other than Germany, because German grading scale is not like USA system. Okay, you'll know later. So when this 3.5, you don't have this 3.5, no need to apply. No need to waste your time with this program or waste your money applying there. Because other than meeting the minimum entry requirements, if there is vacant seats, they will keep it vacant. They don't bother to fulfill all the 30 seats by taking random students. No. All the students must or should fulfill the entry requirements. It could be CGPA, it could be your work experience. Some scholarships want you to have at least 1 or 2 years of work experience. So if you are a fresh graduate, working there is just a waste of time. Next. So when you have answered all these previous 5 questions, now the next thing is you want to search MSc programs. Here I have given you 6 websites. Not only these 6 websites, there are many other websites, but these are to me the most effective websites to look for a MSc program. First of all, if you choose this link, I will provide you the slides. Just go to this link and choose the region Europe, and it will give you all the like from A to Z, country wise, from Austria till let's say like this, serially. Okay, so this is not organized. It will only show you the country and the universities which are there. But to more organize things is this link. When you click there, now they will give you only the country and 2-3 universities, which are the most important or which are most well ranked in this country. So this will be a general website. You can have all the countries in Europe and all the universities there. This will give you some certain universities with certain countries, not everything. And then there is a website called Master's Portal. European students, I got to hear this from one of my colleagues who was studying with me in Germany. I asked him that many times my students from Bangladesh ask me which website I should follow to apply in Europe. And he said, this website, Europeans follow this website. That is EU domain website, Master's Portal. And here, no program or no university is missing here, but you have to search. When you go there, there is a, in the front page, there is a search box. Just type a country or just type nanotechnology, then the European universities which have a master's degree in nanotechnology, all will be listed. And then from, let's say, 10 programs, you choose your program. And then these are also effective, but if you can find here, it would be better. These are also you can see, and it's especially for Germany only. This website is only for Germany. Maybe you already know the name of the website, DEEP. So this is the government funded scholarship. This website is funded by Deutschland government. Germany in German language is Deutschland. So that's why it's DE. So this is the government website. And when something is official, there is no wrong information. So every information here is authentic. If they say you have to give this amount or this, then it will be like this until you pass. That means if you enter in 2017 in a program, until you finish the program, every information provided here in this year will be the same, no change. So these are useful websites to search for a MSc program. Next. I will briefly outline the application process. The application process depends on the country from where you are applying. Let's say for Chinese students, they have a complete set of rules to apply in Germany or anywhere in Europe. But when we are non-EU applicants, non-EU means any country outside of Europe, then there is certain things you should remember, and the most important one is the application deadline. For EU applicants, they are very much flexible. If someone applies, let's say, 1 month before the program starts, maybe they will consider his application. But when someone applies from Bangladesh or from India, he or she should meet the application deadline, because the application, selection, visa processing and class start, there is certain gap. So if you do not apply earlier, then they will consider, okay, his visa processing will take this much time, he can't start the program right now. So maybe because missing of the deadline, your application is just cancelled. So you should be very, very careful about the application deadline. All over Europe, there are two semester system. One semester is called summer semester and one is winter semester or autumn semester or fall semester. Most of the scholarships does not give you a chance to study in summer semester. Mainly scholarships are provided in winter semesters. Winter semesters mean you start your classes from October for Germany. For only Germany it's October. For other countries it's maybe September or August is for Sweden and other Nordic countries. Denmark, Finland, these are for August. September, France is in September, I started in Portugal in September, and only in Germany, because they call it winter semester, they started in October. So to go, let's say you want to go there in 2018 October, then you have to apply in January, latest February 18th. That means when you are starting your program for October, you are finishing your application by February. Then March, April, May, this is the selection process for you, not for EU applicants. They will apply till June or maybe July. But you have to finish your application latest February. If you see a program says the application deadline is 13th March, don't wait to apply for 29th of March. Because till then, they will have a list of students already selected. They will not wait for the last date. If someone is applying at the very last moment, maybe they will consider him for a waiting list, because they already know which they should contact and give them a certain amount of time. Right now, German visa application takes 3.5 months from Bangladesh. So you should know that how much earlier you should apply, and then they will let you know. They will let you know mostly in June or in July, and then you will process your visa from August, September, October, and then you can start your program in October. So for non-EU applicants, the most important thing for me is the application deadline. And then application steps. Most universities require you to fulfill an online application. Online application is nothing but you go to their website, they have certain things you should upload, or there are some information you should type in, and then you just submit this application. The next thing is, whatever you have written in the online application and whatever things you have uploaded, you just print it and then you submit it as a printed application. That means hard copy. You can consider online application just as a soft copy, free of cost. You are just applying online from the university website. And then when you are submitting the printed application, that means you have to submit each and everything that you have included in the online application in a paper based format. Next slide please. So the required documents are, first of all, you have to have a certified copy of your BSc degree. So you should never send your original transcript or original certificates to anywhere during your application. You always have to submit the certified copy. And by certified copy, that means this copy is attested by maybe your registrar or maybe your exam controller of your university. Okay. No certified copy is valid if it is attested by a civil surgeon or a police officer or a member of parliament. No, they will only accept copies by university stamp, and it will be in university envelope. We have a very good system from our exam controller office. If you apply, they will give you at best 10 copies of your BSc certificates and transcripts. So certified copy, you should be very careful. Attestation means attested by university officials, not also from teachers. Always attestation by university officials. And then this one is optional. Some universities, when I was applying in Portugal, they wanted me to have my HSC and SSC. That means they wanted to know my subjects in HSC and SSC. That means whether I was in science group or which subjects I studied. So this is optional. Not every country requires these two, but every country requires your BSc degree and transcript. The next thing and the most vital part of your application is your curriculum vitae. If your CV looks good, you are good. If it looks ugly, you can just imagine that you are not selected for that program. And for Europe, you have a specific format that you should follow. It's called Europass format. You just click to this link, and in the front page, there are several examples for engineers, for doctors, for fresh graduates, and like this. And you choose the best one for you, and then you just edit the information. The format is there, but you have to remove the logo and the other things that are already there, and you just put your information there. But whenever you are applying in a European country, you must format your CV in Europass format. Next, letter of motivation. Who of you already know about this letter of motivation, or sometimes it is named as SOP? Only two. Okay, so what does an SOP stand for? Statement of purpose. And what statement you think is important when you are applying for an MSc degree? Do you want to explain the religious view or the political situation in Bangladesh? Or you want to explain yourself? After CV, the next important thing of your application is your letter of motivation. And first thing first, it should in any way no longer be more than one page, because you are a fresh graduate, so you don't have that much experience to explain in two or three pages. When people are applying for PhD, they say, okay, now you can have two pages for your SOP. But when you are applying only for an MSc degree, your letter of motivation or SOP should be a single page. And font should not be less than 11, best if your font is 12. Because sometimes the professors are, how to say, they are very old and they don't have that much time to go through all your letter of motivation. They will look for certain keywords, that if it is there or not. And if your font is 10, you can read it, I can read it, but he don't bother to read everything and like this. So your SOP should be one page, but it should be readable. It should be in a font, not Comic Sans or something like this. Very much professional font. You can always use Times New Roman. This is worldwide accepted, or Calibri, but not a very hazy font or something like this, which a professor can't read clearly. Okay, so it should be very, very clear. And what are the things you should include in your letter of motivation? I always suggest my students to make it in four parts. That means four paragraphs. In the first paragraph, you should tell them how you get to know about their program. So don't just say that I was searching in Google and I just found and it was like my dream. No, you have to give a certain reference that okay, I chose this program or this university. Maybe one of the faculty member from my university already studied there, or my batchmate or my friend or someone I know is already studying there. It is better if you even give her, give his or her, let's say that he is studying in this program in this university. So I heard about this program from your university. So there should be a specific, you should be specific that how come you know about this program. This is the first paragraph, maximum three lines, maximum three lines. The second paragraph, you introduce yourself and what you did so far and every achievements in your previous career till now. But maybe it could be 8 to 10 lines, not more than that. So first you say why, sorry, how you chose this program, and second you say about yourself. Next thing is you elaborate that how can this program or this university enhance your career steps in future. So they want to know that how can you use the degree they are offering to you in your future life. Do you want to just get a visa and enjoy your life in Europe, or you have a certain motivation, you know very well what you are going to do, how you are going to do, how you want to utilize this degree. Do you want to get a job there, or do you want to come back to Bangladesh and do something here? Whatever is in your mind, just write the two things that you really believe. If you say I want to get a job in your country after completing my degree, they will not bother. But say something which you really believe. Okay, don't fabricate knowledge, because SOP or letter of motivation defines you more than your CV. Because in CV sometimes I say okay, I am proficient in MATLAB, but maybe I am not that much proficient in MATLAB. But when I write something in my letter of motivation that I work with this software for 6 months, they will somehow verify this information. Maybe after you admitted there, they will give you a task and it will be a part of your study that they are looking for a graduate who has a good knowledge of MATLAB, because he wrote in the letter of motivation and we chose him for this. So do not write anything or do not fabricate any information in your letter of motivation. But maybe sometimes we are lenient about the CV. You add 2-3 softwares or 2-3 things. Let's say you say I was a president of AUST Tripoli Society. They will not bother, but they will see okay, he has some organizing capability, something like this. So this is not verifiable, that whether you have, you are the president or VP or not. But when you say I have a proficiency in MATLAB, I was working in my bachelor thesis for 6 months and I know everything, each and everything of MATLAB, then it would be verified someday somewhere. Okay, next. Sometimes in rare cases you need 3 letter of recommendations, but 99% cases you only need 2 recommendation letters. And as a rule of thumb, one of your recommendation letters should be given by the professor who has who was your bachelor thesis instructor. This is a rule of thumb that your bachelor thesis supervisor should give you a recommendation letter. And the second one you can choose from the senior most professors from your faculty members. Okay, it is advisable, but it is not mandatory. It is advisable that you do not take a recommendation letter from lecturers or assistant professors or someone who don't have a very vast experience or don't have a PhD, to be more precise, who don't have a PhD. This recommendation letter is not that much valuable for them. So always try to contact with your thesis supervisor. He should give you a recommendation, and the second one should be the senior most faculty from your department. And to be in the safer side, collect 3, so that if you need 3 in such case, let's say you have everything and then you see okay, this university required 3 recommendation letters, so for this maybe your application process extends for 1 more week. So always collect 3 to be in the safer side and apply with the best 2. You know who will give you the best recommendation, right? So when you are applying, you just give the best 2 recommendations to the university. Next, The next thing is proof of English language proficiency. We all know that when we are applying to universities outside, they always want us to be fluent in English because their language is not English, my language is not English. So we have one thing in common, that is English language. So they are, let's say they have German, their language is German, ours is Bengali, and then one thing is common between us is English. And if students are not that much fluent in English, then it's not a very good thing, because sometimes you have some examinations, oral examinations. In Germany, there are some examinations which is totally oral examination. Maybe you can call it like our bio exams during the lab. But here you have only 5 to 10 minutes to expense with your teacher, but there are 30 minutes exam for a subject of 3 credits and everything is in English. So if your English is not good, you can't explain to the point to the professor, then your marks will be reduced. So to evaluate your English language proficiency, they will focus TOEFL in some cases, but mostly IELTS. IELTS is accepted all over Europe. TOEFL is also accepted, but IELTS, they give more preference to IELTS because they all follow the British systems. And there is no certain boundary, but maybe for TOEFL you can consider the internet based TOEFL IBT score of 92, and for IELTS you can consider 6.5, and in any band you should not get less than 6. That means maybe in listening you are getting 5.5, maybe university will tell you to retake the exam, or maybe this is not the minimum requirement, so your application will be denied. Did you get the point? So when you have IELTS of 6.5, you should have each band equal to 6 or greater than 6, not less than 6. Okay, so be very careful when you are sitting for the IELTS exam or TOEFL exam, that 92 is the base mark in most cases. Sometimes it is 90, sometimes it is 88, not below 88. And for IELTS, sometimes it is 6.0, and at that time 5.5 is the band score for each band, each individual band. And after knowing all these things, who of you was thinking, where is GRE? Okay, so GRE is not mandatory in Europe, but if you have GRE, you have some advantages, some added advantages. Let's say two students having the same potential, you and your friend applied from AUST to a German university, you have everything in common because you have 5 in these two. Let's say you have 3.8, he has 3.78, almost same. And these are not so much variable. So everything is same, only thing you have is GRE and he doesn't have GRE. At that time, the factor which will decide whom to offer the scholarship or whom to offer the admission can be the GRE exam. So if you have GRE, why not utilize this? Okay, but this is not mandatory. As far as I know, only one university in Germany requires GRE, that is RWTH Aachen University. They have in their website written down that GRE is mandatory. Other than this university, as far as I know, no other university in Europe or in Germany require GRE mandatorily. But in their website it's written, GRE, if yes, okay. If no, doesn't matter.
Sir, Next. Sir, if we have GRE, we need IELTS.
Yeah, of course. These two are completely different things. When you are applying for your graduate studies, then GRE means you are more motivated or you are more interested for your graduate studies. This is a different part. But IELTS is mandatory for you. Even in UK, if you want to go to UK with your spouse visa, you have to sit for IELTS general version. Maybe you already know IELTS, there are two versions of IELTS. One is general version and one is academic version. So GRE and IELTS are not comparable. They are not at all comparable. Okay, the next challenge, after application is done, the next challenge, let's say you already get admission from a program, from a university, how to finance your studies. So basically, the most easiest way that you have a scholarship. You already have a scholarship before going there, let's say sir, he has already a scholarship to go for UCF. So if you have a scholarship, no hassle, you just go and enjoy your life. But when you don't have a scholarship, what should you do? I saw that most of the Indian students, they don't at all bother about scholarships. If they get chance in a university where he actually want to study, they take loans from banks. And do you know the interest rate for that loan? Only 2.5%. And this is the highest. That means some banks even offer low rate interest loans. So when we are competing from Bangladesh with Indian students, I didn't got a scholarship, I denied my application, I will not go there. But they don't care, they just go, because 2.5% loan is nothing. You can always pay back this loan if you have a job, at least for 2 years, then you just pay back all the loans that you have. And then there is a special type of maybe grants. Grants means you work for a company, or you work for a research institute at your university, or you just get a grant from somewhere. Because every university have some alumni and they have some rich people in the alumni, and they always give funds that, okay, let's say it's my father's name, I want to introduce a fund of 1000 euro per month for a student. So maybe if you are lucky enough to get a grant, but to take these grants, you have to compete with the local students and in fact students from all departments of that university. So this is very much difficult for you to get the grants. And the most exhausting thing that I consider is work and study together. I didn't want to explain that that much, but I should give you a hint. The people who did odd jobs in Europe and studying there, their life is not stable. Their life is totally unstable. Sometimes due to this work pressure, they just miss exams. And then they miss exam. And after one or two semesters, let's say I completed 60 ECTS. ECTS means credits in European system. And by that time, they completed only 30 or 40 ECTS. Because these odd jobs take more energy from you. Because let's say you are working in a warehouse. 8 hours, you are just transferring things from here to there. And that's it, you are just transferring things. So it's hectic, it gives you pain. So you can't study at night. But the payment is better. Anywhere in Europe, you work for 1 hour, you will get at least 10 euro. 10 euro means around 900 taka, if you compare. But you should not or go for this work and study plan, if possible. If possible, I will say, you take loans from your relatives. They will not ask for interest, right? You take loans from your relatives, or you manage loans somehow. Because if you can finish your study exactly in 4 semesters in 2 years, then life is much more easier for you there. You just apply for a job, you get a job, and then you pay back the loans very easily. But when you are working and studying at the same time, you don't have the study time. You don't have a good CGPA. So ultimately, you will not get a job also. Because they will also consider, as a foreign student, when you complete a degree from Germany, they will consider your CGPA also. Because bachelor degree from Bangladesh is not countable to them. They can't judge students having CGPA 3.9. Everyone having CGPA 3.9. Because when they are giving a, admission to someone from Bangladesh, most of the times they are having the most top CGPA. But when you have a CGPA of, let's say, 4 out of 4 from Germany, then you are really brilliant. They will evaluate you through this. So just ignore these steps. If possible, the best thing is scholarship. The second best is loan. And if you are lucky enough, you can manage a grant.
Sir, what about
language? Language for this odd job?
After
completing graduation. Can I explain it later? So when I'm saying about the scholarship opportunities and you are applying in Europe, first thing that should come to your mind is Erasmus Mundus scholarship programs. They have right now 44 MSc programs there where you can apply. And if you are getting admission in any one of these programs, that means you have a scholarship. Because these programs comes up with a full package. You have a scholarship, you have admission, and then the thing you choose is your university. Which university will go for study. So when you are applying in Europe and you want the scholarship, the first scholarship scheme that you should look for is Erasmus Mundus. You click to this link, in the front page there will be two types, Erasmus Mundus Action 1 and Erasmus Mundus Action 2. Action 1 is for you. When you are a fresh graduate, you want to study in Europe, you want a scholarship, you are for 1. And when you are a faculty member, you want to go there for 3 months or 6 months for research purpose or some experience, then you are in category 2. So never ever apply for category 2. Always apply for category 1. And in Europe, at least I don't know someone in Europe who directly got PhD admission from Bangladesh before doing a master's. So in Erasmus Mundus, you can see parallel programs. The program which is in MSc, maybe this is also offered in PhD. So you should always apply for MSc, okay? Because Europe doesn't give you MS leading PhD or PhD directly. You have to have a MSc degree first. And then if Erasmus Mundus doesn't have the scholarship or doesn't have the program that you want, you can go for topuniversities.com, and this is a very good website. Here country specific scholarships are serially listed like this, again from A to Z, from Austria to Switzerland. So country specific scholarship means Erasmus Mundus has 44 MSc programs, and this is country irrelevant. Every program has 2-3 cooperating universities or coordinating universities, let's say one from Germany, one from France, one from UK. So you can decide where you should go, where you want to go. But when you have a certain preference of country, let's say Germany, then there is some scholarships only for Germany. So if you go through this link, you will see the country specific scholarship. One example is, let's say you are looking for Sweden, and then you will see a scholarship called SI scholarship. Anyone from here know this scholarship name? SI scholarship. This is Swedish Institute scholarship. And right now in Europe, this is the most rewarding scholarship. This one is the most rewarding scholarship. That means in masters, the money that you are getting from other scholarships, here it is much higher in Swedish Institute scholarship. So for country scholarship, country specific scholarship, you will go to this link, and these are some other websites you should also check. This was the company which provided me my scholarship for 24 months, and this was also very handsome amount. I got around 750 euro per month, and this was for 24 months. So this is very much attractive, because here all the programs are based on power and renewable energy, which were my favorite topics. So I just applied and they gave me admission in 2 programs, and then I chose KIT Germany to go for. And my other choice was in Spain. I didn't go there. So under this program, Keep Inno Energy program, there are only 7 master's programs, and these are only for electrical engineers, not for civil, sorry. So these are only for electrical engineers, 7 programs, very specific. One is, let's say, nuclear energy, one is renewable energy, one is energy engineering, then one is smart electrical grid, that means smart grid. So very specific 7 programs, and these programs also, when they give you admission as a non-EU student, it's always provided with scholarship. So if you get admission, mashallah, you don't need to think about your funding or anything. And then some other websites you can look for, but these websites are very important to look for. One is Erasmus Mundus, one is Top Universities for country specific scholarships, and one is, if you are interested in power, then Keep Inno Energy. Next, before I finish, there is a bad news. Till now, all the 9 German states have free tuition. Free tuition means, let's say we consider or we compare with USA. When you get an admission, that doesn't mean your tuition fee is waived. So you, for that you have to work, let's say, as a teaching assistant or research assistant or something like this. But till now, when you get admission from a German university, that indicates your tuition fee is waived, because there is no tuition fee. There is no tuition fee, but there is some registration fee which is around, let's say, 150 euro. If it's too much higher, it starts actually from 100 euro to 150 euro. And if you don't want to ride bike, that means bicycle, then you have to buy a ticket for 100 euro for 6 months for the entire semester. So these two are the only costs that you are having in one semester, 6 months. And otherwise, you don't have till now any tuition fees in Germany. But from 2017, from 2017, that means next winter semester, they will introduce tuition fee and it's 1500 euro per semester. That means for 4 semesters, you need 6000 euro. So now scholarship is mandatory, I think, for most of us. Yeah, because if I also got admission with this boundary, I couldn't afford. So this will be difficult to afford, but there is next slide. And another country which was free till now, when they saw Germany are imposing tuition fees, they also by night, overnight, they decided to impose tuition fees. This is Finland. One country which is still free for European and non-European students is Norway. This country is still free.
Finland is also
free. Free till this year. But from 2017, they are following Germany.
And Estonia is free.
You should never go to Estonia. Estonia, Cyprus, Lithuania. You can always visit there for a trip, but you should never study there. Sometimes I see Poland, then Cyprus, Czech Republic, because I was there. From Bangladesh, it seems every European country is like Germany, but when you are there, you see some countries even have people sleeping in the road at night, literally. So you should never go to Estonia or Cyprus. Norway is cold, but Norway have a better job environment and better scholarships and everything. Because this country, if we consider the GDP wise, Norway is right now the number one in Europe. So next. So the good thing is when you have tuition fees, then universities will provide more and more scholarships to non-EU students, because they always want to have students from all over the world. So if they are imposing tuition fees only for non-EU students, by the way, that 1500 euro is only for us, non-EU students. For European students is always free. So when you have to pay 1500 euro, that means now they will give you admission with a scholarship that your tuition fees will. Something like this in USA. Okay? So don't get disheartened. There are plenty of opportunities. You just have to find the best one for you. Next, I think I have finished already. So wait a moment. Before thinking. Central European countries. By Central European countries, I think I should limit it. I should
limit
it this way. This one?
Netherlands.
This one? Switzerland. Belgium. Denmark, Norway, Sweden, Finland. But these four are not actually Central European, they are Nordic countries. These four are Nordic countries, and Central European I mean Switzerland. Sorry, what is that? Italy. Italy, Switzerland, Belgium, Netherlands, Germany, and France. You should set your focus here. And why I give you this slide? Before sleeping, if you are want to study in Europe, every night before you sleep, you just have a dark game. You throw, and where it ends, you go there. Only in Central Europe. Only. Never ever go to Croatia. Never ever go to Bosnia. Or never ever go to Poland. No. Thank you. Thank you for listening. Wait. First, your question. The language in not only Germany, in all over Europe, they are very, very sensitive with the language. We say we are patriot from Bangladesh, but our patriotism shows only in Facebook status or in 21st February. But when you are walking in a street in France, maybe you are dying and you are asking for help in English, they don't care. You have to ask them in French. Okay. So language, I didn't want to panic you, that's why I didn't tell much about this. Because language, when you have a long-term plan to stay there, maybe in Germany, maybe in France, maybe in Italy, you have to have the language proficiency, local language proficiency. English you should have, your mother language you already have, but you have the local language proficiency. Whenever you are applying for German jobs in websites or somewhere, you are in the first page, you have two options. Are you going to fulfill all the other pages in German or in English? I think when you fill up in English, it's just go to trash. Because I applied to, let's say, 40 to 50 jobs, and I only get return mail from 4 or 5. And in 2-3 mails, they asked me whether we should take your interview through German or through English. So they do not tell you explicitly that you should know German before coming here, but when you are there, you have a master's degree, you have lived there for 2-3 years, they want you to talk in German or at least a certain level of German. Next question.
Is there any regulation for getting visa in Germany, language proficiency?
No. When you are applying for a program which is totally taught in English and you have the admission letter, embassy don't bother about your German proficiency. But to get these odd jobs, sometimes you need German. You want to make friends. By friends, you know what I mean. You have to know the local language. And then for jobs, anywhere outside the university campus, you have to speak their language. Let's say you want to make friends with local citizens and you are discussing in English. After 10 minutes, they just bored and they say, okay, can you speak in German now?
Sir, monthly living expense in Germany.
Monthly living expense in Germany, in a nutshell, it's around 400 euros.
Yes.
Not more than this. And if you divide it, from 200 to 250 is the dorm cost or flat cost where you will live, and you will eat at best 80 to 100 euro. And if you are partying and going outside and traveling here and there, then there will be around 50 euro each month. So you can now divide your living expenses. At best it's 400 euro, not more than that. So when you have 400 euro to expense, why they give you 750 euro?
Yes,
because it's their living standard. They are going to parties on weekend. Friday night, Saturday night, they are partying and they don't have any limit of expense. So it's for them. For us, 750 euro is enough. More than enough, I would say. When you are applying to a European universities, somehow European admission committee is motivated or biased or their CGPA free. That means when, don't get offensive. When you are applying from BU, maybe I am considering you are from Tripoli, and you have a CGPA of 3.5. And somebody applying there and he has 3.99 with the distinction and he has a photo of Chancellor putting it as the gold medal. So they will consider this one is the best university in Bangladesh and he is the best student from Bangladesh. They don't know how BU is conducting their exams or how much difficult it is to get 3.5 even from DU. So for them everything is same. That's why I always say my students that when you apply to a program, you look for parallel programs. Let's say you just don't apply to one university in one program. You have to apply at least 5-6 universities in 5-6 programs. Maybe one or two give you admission, maybe one will give you scholarship. But if you are applying only one or two universities, the chances are very narrow. So wide your, widen your chances. Okay. So more you apply, the more chance that you will get admission or funding. Next. No, no, no.
Study gap.
In some cases, the universities want you to explain in the, your letter of motivation what you did after graduating. Let's say you are graduated in 2014, you are applying in a program to start in 2017. There is a 3 years gap. You should have some hints in your letter of motivation, because in CV you just can't write, I was here at home. In your letter of motivation, maybe you can explain it like this. I was working as a teaching assistant in my university, in my department with this professor, and I have published 2 research articles. No one cares to call your professor and ask if he actually worked or not. But when you have a gap, you have to supplement this gap with something else. Maybe it's a research work, maybe it's a voluntary work, something like this. It's a problem. Sometimes it's a problem, because if you have a gap and someone applying who is just a fresh, they always prefer fresh graduates. For a master's program, they always prefer a fresh graduate.
I heard students request 2,000 hours of job experience.
Yeah, because Swedish Institute Scholarship, they require 2 years of job experience. Yeah, that also. When you are applying for a program under that scholarship, they require 1.5 to 2 years of job. Yeah, sorry, I forgot to give my email ID. You can contact me through this email ID, nahid.eeee.aust@gmail.com. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
One minute. Just to give you a motivation or to inspire you, I have a very close photo bhai of mine from AUST. He is from AUST Tripoli, 23rd batch. And he recently graduated from 2 Technical University of Munich, which is the number 1 ranked technical university in Germany. Mine PID was 3. One is 2, second is RWTH, and third is KIG. So I would like to present you Hosni Mubarak. And I requested him to come today to just show you that some of our graduates where they are studying. And till now he has 5 IEEE papers by his name.